Amen. Brother Raymond, would you open your prayer, please?
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for the joys of our salvation and this opportunity. We can come to your house. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. We know God's in spirit. Those that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. We pray for those that couldn't be here for today. We remember our family on the road traveling. Give them travel mercies and prayer requests that's already been turned in. At Sunday school, there's so many, Lord, that's afflicted in their bodies. They need healing today. We lift them up to you.
Yes.
Remember every soul that don't know you, that free pardon of sin today. They can't be drawn unless you draw them. Work around their car, Lord, help them realize the condition of the soul. They might call upon you before it's eternally too late. Help us, Lord, as we go through life to hold up your name to a lost and dying world. And we know without you, we can do nothing. It's by you and your mercy and your grace, Lord. We have our beings. We thank you, Lord, for that. We pray for the service here today, the preaching and being every part of it. Pray that you give us that anointing, Lord, and your will might be done, and your name might be lifted up above all names. You might draw men unto you, that your will be done. We pray and ask these things and give thanks in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. in joy and happiness. May not always look real joyful, but I've got joy in my heart.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen, Sister Evelyn. Real joy is knowing that he's there for good.
That's right.
That's always. Praise the Lord.
That's right, amen.
Can't lose it.
Right.
Seven times. And then, of course, we go to the Philippines the month of April. We're there for that month usually. And Lord willing, my wife and I will be heading to Japan as soon as we can coordinate with the Wilhites, get some things coordinated there. He's out of the church I used to pastor, Liston, Indiana, and one of my students at college. What a tremendous, tremendous work they're all doing, and we thank for God for the opportunity to go and continue praying for us. I'm an evangelist. I'm an evangelist without borders. I do the same thing in other countries I do here. And so I appreciate the fact that when we rescheduled everything, your pastor was kind enough to allow me to come and share a few thoughts that I have on my heart. Oh my, I had so many thoughts running through my head in Sunday school, and I'm trying to get those blown out a little bit. But it was a wonderful, wonderful thought. And what happened when you go to church? You read your Bible, or I'm studying a message, or somebody's preaching, and while the Holy Spirit anointing oil is on the sermon and on the Bible, I'm just glancing at my Bible. I'm seeing things because of the Holy Spirit's illumination at that period of time, where I'm listening to a song, and all of a sudden, here's all these things coming up. But I want to talk to us about a lesson we need to learn. And I'm afraid if I've learned anything in the 45 years I've been saved, I guarantee you I learned it the hard way. I didn't learn it the easy way. I'm hard-headed, stubborn. Just be quiet. Boy, I tell you, many men are going to die of stubbornness, and I keep saying, no, I won't. I'll tell you, it's good. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Thank you for your prayers, your support, your help. You care for us and your smiles. I thank God when I come to this church, I get people that smile at me. They don't just break down laughing. I appreciate that. It's helpful. Oh, my goodness. Well, I'll tell you what. Just the Lord, thank you. I'm telling you, there's joy in this journey.
Amen.
You've given it to me. I think the Holy Ghost is prompting her to do that today. I know most people, we all know this familiar story. I'm going to take a little different direction today. But I want us to learn a lesson. Look at chapter 11, verse number 25. Then David said unto the messenger, thus shalt thou say unto Joab, let not this thing displease thee, for the sword devoureth one as well as another. Make thy battle more strong against the city, and overthrow it, and encourage thy him. And when the wife of Uriah heard that Uriah, her husband, was dead, she mourned for her husband. And when the mourning was past, David sent and fetched her to his house, and she became his wife and bare him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. Listen, life is tough, but as long as we know the Lord is smiling on us, it makes life go better.
Amen.
And we all desire the smile. Look on his face, yeah. The Sunday school lesson said. We need to see his face.
Amen.
That's why I said the first minute, thou shalt have no other gods before me. That Hebrew word means in my face. Get those things out of my face. Don't bring that. Don't bring that to the house of God. Don't bring that to church. Don't bring that to your prayer closet. Get those things, your other things you're trusting or idolizing, get them out of your life and come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name. And so David displeased the Lord, and we know the dirty sin and the wickedness and all the stuff that went on. But in chapter 12, it said the Lord sent Nathan. God sent a preacher. Don't ever think that the preachers come here to straighten you out or me out. We're just water boys. We're messengers. And I guarantee you, every time I or your pastors ever preach, and especially if you preach a hard message, the one doing the preaching is under far more conviction than the person receiving it.
Right.
Yeah. It's a tough thing. How dare I preach anything that's tough or intimidating or scolding or anything like that? Oh my, I tell you, I deserve hell this day.
Yes.
I knew I was bad 45 years ago when I got saved on Thanksgiving night, 1973. I remember that. I remember I was bad. Religious loss. But after reading and studying the Bible for 45 more years, I'm far worse than I thought I was.
That's right.
Help us, Lord.
Yeah.
Yes, Lord.
And he dared to love me.
Yes.
And he came looking for me.
Yeah.
He found me.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, I appreciate what God did. God sent a man. He sent Nathan. I tell you, David got so upset at Nathan for putting his finger in his face and pointing out his sin and calling the chastisement of God upon him, and it never left him after that. I mean, the sword never departed out of his mouth. He had misery in his life, but he still found joy. You read some of those Psalms, and the joy kept coming, restoring to me the joy of thy salvation. And God did. Thank God for the grace of God.
Yes,
that in spite of all we are and all we do, he still gives us grace. But he got so upset at Nathan that the next son that Bathsheba bore him, because this is not the next son he named Nathan. After the preacher that put his finger in his face.
Okay.
And that son is the one that Jesus came through.
Amen.
Now follow him. Through Nathan. And so the preacher's investing in your life. The pastor's investing in your life. The Sunday school teachers are investing in your life. And it's going to have eternal effect if you'll allow it to. He said, he came unto him and said to him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. We know who these characters are. You've heard this all your Christian experience. The rich man had exceeding many flocks. Of course, the rich man represents the King David. The poor man represents the poor soldier, Uriah the Hittite, who converted, changed his culture, changed his commitment, and came over from the Hittites and became one of David's chief personal warriors, personal bodyguards, the 33 of the elite, that special group of Delta Force, SEAL Team 6,
amen,
all those kind of things.
Amen. And
he became David's man, a go-to man, sent him to the great battles, and oh, how he represented well. There was only 30, but there were 33 total, but only 30 at a time, because some of them did die even in battle. And here's an example. Uriah did die. But the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb. That represents Bathsheba. Now, I know how I've preached it, and most of us do preach it, but you won't find in the Bible any negatives toward Bathsheba concerning this whole mess. She's the ewe lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his bosom and was unto him as a daughter. And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock. David had at least four wives by this time anyway. And so he said, spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd, and to dress for the wayfaring man that was coming to him, but took the poor man's lamb, dressed it for the man that was coming to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that hath done this thing shall surely die. Did you know that there is no offering in the Old Testament for anybody that commits these murder, adultery? In the Old Testament, the Bible says they died without mercy under two or three witnesses. There was no mercy in the Old Testament. Under the law, there's no works of the law that could save any of them. There was no sacrifice. You're dead.
That's right.
So David cried out in Psalm 51, according to the multitude of thy tender mercy, blot out my transgression. How were your sins blotted out? Blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, nailing it to his cross. He was still looking forward to Jesus Christ coming to this world,
yes,
dying on that cross, and canceling out the blood guiltiness that he carried over this wound. And David's anger was kindled. But verse 6, he said, he shall restore the land fourfold because he did this thing, because he had no pity. And Nathan said, David, Michael, Brad, thou art the man. You ever had the Holy Ghost tell you, when you're thinking of somebody else? No, that's you. It's you I'm talking to. So this message today is not to David, the king. It might be for you.
That's right.
Yeah.
Just give me a few moments, and Let somebody puts his pants on the same way you do, has the same issues you do, has the same problems you do, has the same weaknesses you do. And let me speak for God. And you decide what you're going to do with the message. He said, thou art the man, doth the Lord God of Israel. I anointed thee king over Israel. I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul. I gave thee thy master's house and thy master's wives into thy bosom, and gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have moreover given unto thee such and such things. How much God has given to us, and we keep on doing the wrong things, making the wrong choices. A lot of them because we don't carry it to prayer. We don't get in front of God and all those other things.
Help.
That's true.
Yeah.
But I guarantee you, 90% of most of our prayers are nothing more or less than giving God counsel.
Ouch.
If you knew what I knew about this situation, God, here's how you do it. God doesn't need advice. He doesn't need counsel.
Right.
But he does want you, as we learned that lesson, this full of stuff today. He wants us to sit, let's talk this over.
That's right.
Let's talk about it.
That's right.
That's where we learn. The children finally sit down and let mom and dad explain. It's not just this is it, this is the way, my way, highway. No, listen. There's reasons we have. God said, there's reasons I have these laws. He's a ruler, but a lot of people to this day want a God that's the ruler, but no rules. He has no rules. He's no ruler. We have a rebellious streak right down inside this bosom of ours, right down inside our soul. That old nature has not changed since the day I got saved. Because God didn't convert the old man. He put a new man in.
Amen. That's right.
The old man is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. Phariseeism, all that does is try to help correct that old man and make him behave a little better. No, you've got to be converted. You've got to be born again. You've got to be changed. You've got to have a new person born inside of you that from that day forward will be in conflict with that old man.
Right.
He said, now, Nathan, I did all this for you, and I would have done more. He said, verse 9, wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain him with the sword of the children of Ammon. You let the enemy kill him. Now here's my thought. My thought is about how dastardly the deed was that David did. There's no doubt about it. But power corrupts.
That's right. Yeah.
And absolute power corrupts absolutely.
That's right.
And David had the power of life and death. Was in the tongue. He was the king. We understand that Bathsheba was there. She was bathing on the roof. Now, I've been all over the Orient. I've been all over, by God's good grace, I've been in many countries, and I've watched them take baths. Today, they still do it the same way they did in the Old Testament time. They go into the city pump, the city well, the city street, and they, with their clothes on, they dump the water on their head, and they start soaping up underneath their clothes. They wash. They still do that. They do that in many of the Arab nations still do that. In Philippines, they do it. In India, they do it. They do it down the river. They wash under their clothes, and they dump the water back on, and they rinse off a little bit. Then they go home and change their clothes. We don't know that she took her clothes off. But even if she did, David was in the wrong place at the wrong time,
right,
spending a little bit too much time there.
When
he should have been out, it was time for kings to go out to battle. He was walking along the roof, and he saw a beautiful woman taking a bath.
Yeah.
And we don't turn the television off when that happens.
Help us, Lord.
Yeah.
We don't close the book when it gets to describing it. We go on. It'll change.
Yeah.
Preach to yourself, brother man. Okay.
Help me.
Yeah, I hope something gets off on you a little bit.
Yeah.
I would have given you more. We know about her. You know, he didn't get her the first time. The Bible says David sent messengers.
Yeah.
won her over. Said flowers and candy. Said, I noticed you, and I'm the king. I got beautiful red hair. Not me, David. So you probably have beautiful red hair sometime. It's gone. And nobody remembers verse number 23. But now he is dead. Wherefore shall I pass? Shall I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me.
That's right.
We have the king. We have the ewe lamb. We have the poor man. And we don't even see or hear another word about the traveler. Who did he do this for? Somebody was going to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. The traveler.
Yeah.
David got left holding the dead baby. And the traveler moved on. Who's responsible? David. Who's responsible? Perhaps Bathsheba. Who's responsible? Sin lies in our own bosom.
Yeah.
As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Mm. We sin when we are drawn away of our own lusts and entice.
Amen.
But there is an enticer.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's somebody that's been paying attention for 6,000 years on this planet.
That's right.
He knows us. Mm. He's seen how flesh works. He knows how to just pass by, plant a thought. I call it, he goes by and just pushes our button. Mm.
That's right.
I've said it here, I sure have said it here. I believe in eternal security, but if you could lose it, it'd be on I-65 somewhere between Louisville and Indianapolis. You talk about road rage, you talk about Pula. You better be glad I'm driving a Prius. Pedal as fast as I can't catch this guy. But the traveler, he goes to and fro. Why? He was kicked out of heaven. He's exiled to this planet. He came down probably in the Garden of Eden, and the first thing he did was go by Eve and pushed her buttons.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
And she was left holding an old fig apron. And he's gone. You don't see him mentioned again in Genesis.
That's right.
Traveler came by and he's gone. Beware of the thought.
Right.
Well, you can't help your thoughts, but you don't have to let the bird build a nest in your head.
Yeah.
You don't have to respond. You need to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Mm. How do you do that? Well, you better keep his word in front of you.
Amen.
You gotta keep his thoughts in your mind. Gotta keep his, how's God think about that? What's God think about that? What should I do with that? The traveler. Job was going pretty well, wasn't he? He had a hedge about him. Yeah. Read Job 29. You wanna know what it's like to be a blessed man in this world? Read chapter 29. So, I mean, he said, the presses burst out oil and the olive oil and the butter. And he said, I bathed my path with it. And he said, everybody stood up when I walked in the room. And everybody's dick-yacking and having conversation until I walked in the room. And then they all quiet. And they'd look to me to see if I had wisdom. And he had wisdom. And he said, the widows rejoiced in my presence because I saw somebody taking advantage of them, I'd break their jaws and give it back to them. He was a Robin Hood. He was a hero's hero. He was a good guy. He didn't know his heart. God did.
Yeah.
It was God that started this thing with Job. It wasn't Job. It wasn't that. God said, hey, hast thou considered my servant Job? There's none like him. Right? righteous man, one who fears God, eschews evil. Why don't you take him on? God started that fight.
That's right.
Why does God allow this guy, this personality, to go to and fro to this world to reveal our character?
That's right.
Yeah, that's right.
To reveal our problem, to reveal our needs. Job, Satan came in among them when the sons of God came together, and Job met with his family, but he also met with God's people. And anytime God's people get together, somebody else comes in the midst of it. Satan came in also among them. Now, a lot of people think, that's heaven. He's denied access to heaven. But he comes in among the brethren, and he puts a thought, accusing the brethren, accuses the sister. Where'd that thought come from? He's among us here today. He's here. Thank God there's another.
Yeah,
walking
man.
In the midst where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I. Satan's a strong man. He can convince you. He can out-argue you. I don't care how many parables they write about Daniel Webster and the devil and Daniel Webster. Daniel Webster could not out-argue the devil.
That's right.
You can't either.
That's right.
You don't stand a chance against him. But there's one with us.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's right.
Thank you.
Amen.
Well, yeah. The little girls got it right when somebody asked her, what would you do if the bad men were at the door, banging on the door, and knocking on the door and said, let me in, let me in. And she said, I'd just send Jesus to the door.
That's good. Amen.
Thank you. So Job got left with the ashes. David got left over with a baby, Deborah. Judas. Why have you allowed Satan to plant this thought to betray the Son of God? Jesus blamed the devil for that. It was Judas that responded to it. That's Judas's fault. And Judas was left holding the bag. He said, I have betrayed innocent blood.
That's right.
Yeah.
And went out and hung himself. There's no God about all that. He repented himself.
Yeah.
That won't work. It's repentance toward God.
That's right.
I met myself. Now, I shouldn't have done that. That's self-regret. That's self-repentance. That don't work. But when you realize you're sorry, you change your mind because you've sinned against a thrice holy God.
Mm-hmm.
That's repentance.
Yeah. Yeah.
The traveler came by. Job's life, Eve's life, Judas's life, Ananias and Sapphira, Acts chapter 5.
Yeah.
Who did that? Well, you don't find evidence of the devil after he's been someplace. You get left holding the bag. You get left holding the dead baby. You get left with the circumstances. You and I choose our sins, but we do not choose the consequences.
That's right.
Yeah.
And there are consequences. Mm-hmm. You can get forgiveness and nothing change except your standing before God. You don't get your eye back if you get it poked out in the fight. You don't get your arm back on if it gets infected and you get shot by the rebels. Excuse me. That was Stonewall Jackson. Sorry. But,
come on.
Yeah, you know, you might die of pneumonia, but you get your sins forgiven. I'm not implying Stonewall needed his sins forgiven. He hated slavery, and supported the blacks. And he took care of a Sunday school for hundreds of black children.
That's right.
His whole life. But and neither did Robert E. Lee have slaves, but Grant did. But it's okay. That's my history lesson.
Hey.
Where that came from? Okay, it was my responsibility to speak that or not speak that. Somebody else planted the thought. And I'm supposed to filter it through the Bible and find out where that come from. Well, I wasn't attacking anybody. I was just... So that was Mike Thurman. That's free of charge. But I'm trying to get back to what the Holy Ghost wants me to say, please. Ananias and Sapphira, he said, why has Satan prompted thy heart to lie to the Holy Ghost? Don't raise your hand. How many of you tithe? Don't raise your hand. If you would have raised your hand and you really don't, you lied to the Holy Ghost.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, I just skipped three Sundays, but I'm going to start tithing again. You can tithe. You got to make it up.
Yeah.
Everybody said, well, I got my rights. How about the Holy Spirit having his rights again? How about him having his way in our life? You know why the joy disappears? We lose it. Why? Ananias and Sapphira, saved by the good grace of God. They're saved. They're part of church. They're giving things away. They're doing great things. But they conspire together to make themselves look more spiritual than they really are. Like we do when we go to church. We've argued with the children, arguing with the wife. You sorry thing, you sorrier than me, and coming to church, going to the house of God. Good morning, everybody. Everything's wonderful here. I am so glad to be at the house of God. But see, God knows.
That's right.
Yeah.
But I still don't want people to know everything about me. I'm still going to put the best face on it I can. Yeah. But I know in my heart I'm not fooling him.
That's right. Right.
Okay? Because he knows my heart.
Yeah.
And my heart can deceive me, and Satan can use my heart to deceive me. Mm. And that's where we find most of these people. There was an emotional tie into almost all of these things. So we have Job, we have King David, we have Judas, we have Joshua the high priest in Zechariah chapter 3, verse 1 through 7. He was presented to be the high priest of Israel. This Joshua, different Joshua than we learned about in Joshua chapter 9 this morning. But he was the high priest, and Satan stood at his side accusing him and said, you're not worthy, you can't do this, your garments are dirty, and all this. And to turn him aside, Satan came by. I've had Satan say to me at the Lord's Supper time, well, Jesus said, whosoever eateth this and drinketh of this cup unworthily, and all that. Well, I'm not going to eat or drink it unworthily. Well, that's why the pastor gives you time to meditate and confess your, get yourself right. That's because right. He commanded his disciples, drink ye all of it.
Yeah.
That's right.
That's right.
That's right.
You can't get out of it just because you don't drink it. Amen. You're just as guilty.
Amen. Mm.
That's how he chastens and cleanses his local churches. If we don't get it right, then we are under chastisement. Until we do get it right. Boy, this devil's a mean character.
Yeah.
It doesn't just reveal the character of the people, it revealed his character. Mm. He's without mercy.
Yeah.
And we get down on the devil's level so many times in the way we treat people. Stand against sin with all your might. Preach against sin. Preach that don't do it. Don't do it. If they do, preach with just as much zeal, just as much vigor, just as much authority. To get them up and get them out of it. Get them cleansed. Get them standing up. Get them going for God again.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen.
All of us, we are what we are by the grace of God.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
David. Satan prompted David to number Israel. Been left out. Yeah. And this leaves everybody standing in the ashes. Everybody standing in the circumstances. And then he leaves town. Don't you just hate people like that? It's like whenever there's some people I have in my life that most of my sins that I did as a teenager, I did because of peer pressure. I wanted acceptance. Thank God I hated the taste of liquor. But I drank it.
Yeah.
For my buds. Mm. But thank God I didn't like it. I smoked cigarettes. But I wanted to be a championship wrestler. Not WWF or whatever that is. But I wanted to win in college and high school, but, so I didn't do it because I wanted to stay in shape.
Yeah.
That's what, but if I did it because it made me look cool in front of my peers. But the peers are gone. There's some people I've met that are like, talking about busload of peer pressure. I've had people come into my church as a pastor that they had so much influence just by coming in, they almost persuaded the church away. I mean, it's like, they're cool, they're beautiful, they're talented. All those things the devil is. Beautiful, talented, intelligent, cool, calm, collected. That's the only reason I'm like this, because I don't want to be like the devil. Excuse me. The devil has coming down now. He's coming among people now, knowing he hath but a short time. He's on a short. His fuse is lit. He's about to explode. He's running over people's lives nowadays like a bulldozer with his throttle stuck open. And you and I don't have to get on his level. Even the Lord is coming soon. It's imminent. It could be any time. But when imminency becomes immediacy, you better not blink.
Yeah.
He numbered Israel in 77,000 innocent people died just because the devil prompted. You need to find out how many people's in your kingdom. You need to number your army. You need to see how powerful you are. You need to see how politically high you are. You need to understand. And that's the devil prompting human pride. And even the carnal man Joab said, David, you shouldn't do that. Be it ever so, he said, let it be 10 times more than they really are. But David had well over a million man army. There was nobody could challenge him. Solomon carried that over. God brought them both down. Because Satan just prompted, just put the thought in there. That thought. The thought of foolishness is sin. Just the thought. Because it can prompt us to do something with it. Preachers are brought down by personalities or powers or influence or beauty or money or just carnal flesh. A man can be bought for a piece of bread. Esau proved it. A bowl of soup. A mess of pottage. It doesn't take much. So when a traveler comes by, thought goes through your mind. What are you going to do with it? Filter through the Word of God. This is our Father filter.
Yeah.
Filter everything you see and hear and everything you think.
Amen.
Filter it through this Bible. God's given you a principle, a promise, a procedure in this book so that you can categorize it and analyze it and know if it's of God. But don't do anything with it until you filter it. The wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God.
Amen.
Sometimes, if I got some loved ones that if I thought you could go beat the devil out of it and put Jesus in there, I'd let you do it. But it ain't going to work. They have to receive it of their own free will.
That's right.
God has proven over and over and over he can push and punish and fire from heaven and this and that and thorns and scorpions and all that. But it said in the book of Revelation, they still harden their heart. Harden their heart. So we offer grace because it's the goodness of God that leads men to repentance.
Amen.
What got me right with God? It wasn't really the thought, after I got saved, it wasn't the thought of hell. It was the fact that, He keeps blessing me and using me in spite of me, and I feel this big, and how he loved me anyway, and just keeps on loving me, and you're good to me, and you deserve better than I've done. I'm going to get this thing right.
Right.
The goodness of God that leads me into repentance,
not
the wrath of God. But you can't escape the wrath of God.
That's right.
It's coming. So I'm just saying, Don't get too focused on just David. Don't get too focused on just Bathsheba or the prophet. Don't just get, but realize there is an enemy that's passing by at different times. You may go without it many years, and then all of a sudden, boom. And Satan knows you're loving. Lonely, somebody's loneliness. So, Satan puts by. Get under real financial straits, and here's an opportunity. Satan just pushes the button, leaves town. And then after the dust is settled, you're standing there.
That's right.
Beaten and defeated. Who did that? It was Satan, the traveler. How about Peter? Satan desired to have that he might sift you as wheat. Satan was after Peter, not Judas. Satan was after Peter because he was a leader. But he couldn't get Peter, so he settled for Judas. Because Judas responded. And so we find Peter was overwhelmed by fear and accusation. Who did that? But we don't see him anymore. After he got Peter to do all that, denying the Lord, blaspheming the Lord, cursing and swearing, Satan's gone.
That's right.
And Peter's left in the bottom of his boat on those old ropes, walking back and forth, weeping and wailing that he had sinned against his Savior, his Master. But may I just not hesitate to say this. He's a strong man. When Satan comes, he's strong. Strong, powerful influence, strong wisdom, strong opportunity. He's very influential, very powerful.
Yeah.
And he's the prince of power of the air, and he's the king of this world. When a strong man comes to your house, he binds the owner of the house, that's you and me. And we become helpless. We come under his influence. He takes up residence until we receive Jesus Christ.
That's right.
The Bible said Jesus said, then what a stronger than him.
Yes, man.
Whenever you have those struggles, he's as close as the mention of his name. Jesus, Jesus.
Yeah.
You surprise what happens.
Yeah.
Now the disciples were struggling out in the storm, and Jesus went by walking on the water, and he went as though he would have passed them by. He only goes where he's invited.
Yeah.
God is an absolute gentleman. If you're here today and you're not saved, he will not take you to heaven kicking and screaming. If you want to go to hell, he'll allow it. He will not kick your door in. He will not invade your territory. He will not even go to your wedding unless he's invited. And he won't even do anything about in the wedding about the wine unless somebody asks him. So when all this stuff comes in and you start seeing the evidence, you've been under the influence. Some of us are under the influence of liquor. Some are under the influence of people. Sometimes it's personality. Sometimes it's opportunity. Get Jesus back in the midst. When churches are struggling and they're backbiting and they're fighting each other, church splits are happening and all that kind of stuff and they're fighting, put Jesus back in the middle where it belongs.
Yeah.
Let Jesus walk in. And as we said in Joshua chapter 9, I'm not going to get out of that chapter. And he gave the illustration again when Joshua went out to meet the angel or the Christophany. Are you for us or for our adversary? The man stood there with the sword and said, nay, I'm not for you or against you. I didn't come here to take sides. I came here to take over.
That's right.
Amen.
He doesn't come to make one side win He comes to defeat both sides.
Amen.
Says, I'm the master.
That's right.
I'm the king. I'm the boss. Nothing less will do for Jesus. I am the shepherd.
That's right.
So, next time that traveler comes through, you sense it because you have someone in you, the Holy Ghost.
That's right.
He, a flag goes up.
That's right.
Something wrong with this.
Amen.
I don't know what it is, but I'm going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
Nathan's going to come preach to you. Get Jesus back in the middle of it.
Yes, man.
Get Jesus back in the middle of your singing. I'll just close with this thought about the ministry God's called. I pastored almost 25 years. Then just finished. I'm entering my 16th year in evangelism. And some people say, well, that means you're just out soul winning. No, the office of evangelist is to keep it all about the evangel. Who's the evangel? What's this all about? What's all of this about? Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Jesus.
Keep it all about you. Keep everything focused on you. And I'll be honest with you. As soon as any service or church or singing or anything stops being about him, I'm pretty much done with it.
Yeah.
Right.
When soul winning becomes more about how many I'm winning than it is about who's getting in there.
Yeah. Come on.
I'm pretty much done with that kind of stuff.
Mm.
I'm interested in Jesus Christ being honored and glorified and magnified and somebody touching his garment. I'm interested in that. I'm more interested in Jesus getting glorified than I am in what he's going to do for you.
Yeah, amen.
With that song, that's he'd good. Still been God even if he never calmed the storm over.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
How much more do you want him to do? Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Oh, amen.
Especially when the traveler comes through. And you can't stop the traveler from coming through. He's coming through. He's coming through.
Help us, Lord.
But let Jesus have the greater influence.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Keep,
amen.
Keep your heart in tune with heaven.
Amen.
Keep your eyes on the promises and the principles and the precepts of this book.
That's right.
Amen.
And it can't get you.
Amen. That's right. Amen.
So how you been doing with this traveler? Most of the time, David didn't recognize him. Eve didn't really recognize him. Job didn't really recognize him. He didn't even understand that what was going on. Nowhere in the Bible. But he's there. And he's passing through.
That's right.
Yep.
He blows in, blows up, blows out. Oh, that's evangelism. He comes in and messes with you. So don't get upset when the preacher preaches.
Amen.
Amen.
Father, let me ask your blessings on the message. Thank you for the kindness. Thank you for the kindness of the church, the love. But God, help us to be wary, be sober, be vigilant for our adversary. The devil as a roaring lion, walking about, seeking whom he may devour. Do it for Jesus' sake.
Amen. Amen. Let's all stand with every head bowed and every eye closed. Amen. This is our place. You got a need. You got a trial. You got a trouble. I've got good news. There's one that's able this morning. He knows you're weak. He's strong. You can't do it. You need him. Give it to Jesus. Give it to him. You've got to worry. He'll take care of it. You've got something that's got a hold of you. Give it to him. What to do, he knows what to do.
Yes. Yes.
need him in our marriages, we need him in our workplace, we need him in our relationships, in our life.
Amen.
Trusting and believing in that precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.